kind of interesting that I got set into this co-evolution section because I am really mostly a paleontologist, but I hope I'm going to be able to make the case that we can travel back in time and actually, using the fossil record, discuss co-evolution in quite ancient history. One big thing in microbiome studies that people are really excited about is, and some of what has been talked about already, is evolution of the gut microbiota. And in particular, if we think about the evolution of metazoans, differentiated tissues, and in particular the gut, evolved very early. And a lot of the microbial taxa are quite diverse within the gut specifically. So I'm just highlighting the proteobacteria in the human microbiome in this really cool diagram. And I wanted to study the timing of their evolution in order to compare it with the timing of evolution of metazoans. In order to do this, most of bacterial work is done using the genomic record, because obviously there are no fossils for these taxa. But as a paleontologist, I work with the geological record, and these can actually be combined together and make a fuller picture of the history of evolutionary time. So my background is mostly in working with arthropod calibration fossils, which I reviewed very extensively in a paper that they told me so long it could have been a book, and it was longer than my thesis, but there's all pictures. So this sort of work was used to calibrate molecular phylogenies of arthropod evolution. And it's great because there are so many taxa, because arthropods have hard body parts that fossilize. However, the tree of life, including bacteria, way predate any fossil record, and we just don't have enough direct information from the rock record for the majority of that history. So what are the kinds of approaches that we can use to time calibrate a molecular phylogeny in the same way that we did with metazoans? Well, one thing that was developed together with my postdoc advisor, Greg Fournier, and I, which we have out in a preprint, was this method that, well, in review they told us we can't call it TARDIS, but it's in the talk anyway. And it involves a really important method that is usually thought of as a hindrance to bacterial evolution, which is horizontal gene transfers. So when you have from a donor clade, which is indicated by the circle there, into a recipient clade, say that that recipient clade is, you know, usually it's between bacteria, but say that it's a eukaryotic clade that contains fossils, then actually that allows us to put this onto an evolutionary timescale, because you know that the donor clade must be older than the recipient, and the recipient has a fossil age, so that allows you to put a prior for Bayesian phylogeny. So we identified within the proteobacteria a couple of these situations. So this is a gene tree made by a graduate student who worked with us. Sorry, it's a bit ugly here, but essentially this gene was horizontally transferred from within a subclade of gamma proteobacteria into this clade with the yellow unreadable text, and that clade is a series of small eukaryotes, including diatoms and coccolithophores, which have a very rich fossil record. And so from that, there's an existing molecular clock age estimate suggesting that the donor clade, which cannot be older than the recipient clade, must therefore not be older than 1.4 billion years old. My advisor and one of our lab mates also published in Nature this gene that was transferred from actually within eukaryotes to bacteria, which is quite rare, and it's a gene that's for sterile biosynthesis. And so from within algae, it was transferred to this subgroup of bacteria. So we also have a prior for that that's actually going the other direction, a maximum age. There's only so many horizontal gene transfers that we have identified at the moment, and for some of the shallower evolution, we can actually use, this is the co-evolution part, perhaps, calibration by host symbiont co-speciation. This is not a novel idea, of course, but the idea is that if you have a bacterial clade that has a phylogeny matching its host, then you can sort of slap the age of the host clade onto the bacteria, and it will help improve your age estimates of the whole thing. So one example that we have in here is actually from beta proteobacteria, this cool symbiosis where mealybugs have this nested set of bacteria inside their cells. So the beta proteobacteria, Tremblia, does co-speciate. So there's the host, sorry, this is really hard to read. The host is on the left, which is the phylogeny of the insect. And then on the right, oh, I'm sorry, this really doesn't show up on the screen here. But basically it's the same with the pink taxa that should have the same phylogenetic relationship. And so there's a fossil, for example, for Pseudococcygae that is from Lebanese amber, so that we know this is the minimum age, about 130 million years ago, from this fossil, and then the maximum age of this could come from a molecular clock estimate of Pseudococcygae around 300 million years ago. A special case of this sort of co-evolution is actually the mitochondria. Textbook familiar, we know that bacterial cell was engulfed by the ancestral eukaryotic cell, and then they sort of kept going with their own genome inside. And molecular phylogenetic analysis has indicated that the original bacterial donor was within alpha proteobacteria. So it's, here's a pointer. It's here on the tree. So this we actually included directly into our molecular phylogeny. So this is the time tree that we built in PhyloDays using a topology that we had also validated in RaxML. And this is so brand new that I got this phylogeny yesterday. While I was running around Barcelona, my student was doing all of this work and I was like texting her from the plane. So the mitochondrial priors that we used were over here. And this is actually eukaryotic mitochondrial genes that are included into this phylogeny. So those fossil ages are from eukaryotic evolution. These are the two horizontal gene transfers that I mentioned within gamma proteobacteria. And then these are several co-speciation events that are obviously much shallower than the tree, generally within the Mesozoic and the Cenozoic. And then there's also one from an organic biomarker that is exclusive to this clade of bacteria. So one thing that I am going to come back to, but that was really exciting to me, is that two of the clades that are most prevalent within gut microbiota are Enterobacterialis and Vibrionalis. And keep in mind what this is here, and I'm going to come back to what that timing means for coevolution. The relative contribution of the calibrations actually is most strongly driven by the coevolutionary ones that we included. We don't have a convergence for one where we removed the mitochondrial calibrations yet. That was still in the burn-in last night. So basically, these are showing the confidence intervals from molecular clock analysis where the type listed was removed and inclusive is with everything included. And the only ones that differed were actually the ones where we removed the coevolutionary calibrations. I think the reason why those contributed more significantly to the molecular clock is because they had both a maximum and a minimum age. So there was a narrower confidence interval in the prior that was included. Of course, using an a posteriori method like this is not going to tell you perfectly about the evolution of the priors, because the actual prior that is incorporated into the analysis is based on the interaction of different priors, but there's so few in this. 13 calibrations for 203 taxa. This is kind of reasonable, especially since we're working with bacteria. So I wanted to just play around and see if I could, you know, plug some of this into doing these phylogenetic comparative methods and to see if, hey, there looks visually from this lineage through time plot to actually be an early burst of speciation in the early evolution of the proteobacteria. So that was cool, but I wanted to take a look at the diversification statistics a little closer. So a gamma statistic is basically determining whether there was a slowdown in the rate of evolution if it's less than zero. And we got quite a highly negative value and a significant p-value. So that does suggest an early burst. The problem is that this doesn't really account for actually taxon sampling. So the MCCR test is simulating based on the number of taxa that you have sampled versus the amount of taxa that are estimated to be in the clade, which actually we don't even have a really good estimate of that for gamma proteobacteria. My student basically has a rap song called Too Many Gammas because there's so many when you blast for them. So I just put in some huge estimate, like 30,000 taxa, which is probably way, way fewer than there actually are. And then we saw that this is actually really insignificant. So really, we don't have statistical support for an early burst or any diversification fit model, even though it visually looks like it in the phylogeny. So I would say maybe there was an early burst, but the taxon sampling is too low. And when you have that, obviously any more recent speciation events are basically hidden from the phylogeny because you don't have the taxa that represent them. So it would simulate seeing a slowdown in their rate of speciation. So I think maybe it's a bit premature to try and apply this with these data. But on the other hand, trying to add 30,000 taxa, you can't run phylobase. So they've been working on this with metazoan evolution for a long time. This is sort of the first attempt in bacteria. So coming back to these two clades, the Vibrionalis and the Enterobacterialis, I'm still really excited, and this is like the hot point of this project, I think, even if we can't maybe do a lot of statistical power with this. What we do see is that the confidence interval of the estimate of divergence for these, and this is from the inclusive tree, is actually right in the sweet spot in the end of the Neoproterozoic, which is at the same time when the phylogeny that I started with the evolution of Bilateria and maybe Cnidarians, began. So differentiated tissues of metazoans were beginning to evolve at the exact same time in Earth history that we infer the evolution of the two groups that are most prevalent in the gut microbiota. So these are some examples of Eacheron potential stem group Bilaterians or metazoans. In fact, this thing called Dyna is like a tube that basically has been estimated to be potentially having a gut, and the tube that is preserved is from its burrow. And then even a bit later, when the diversification of these clades might have been occurring, is when true metazoans, such as Olivinia, the greatest organism that ever lived, had evolved already. So I still think this is pretty exciting that we can show with essentially independent data that the timing of evolution of gut bacteria was concordant with the timing of evolution of the gut anatomy. Basically, their habitats were evolving at the same time that they were. That's really, really cool. So I really, really, really want to thank everyone in my lab. So Greg Fournier is my advisor. Sarah Schwartz is the student who did most of this work. I was like texting her, explaining to her how to use phylobase on the plane. She's a rock star. And Phil like jumped into the fray. And Greg Shelmar, our cluster guy, he worked until 8 p.m. on a Friday to get this running, so I can trace to show you. So these guys are amazing, and thanks so much for coming, and I guess I have a couple minutes for questions. Yes?
Can you infer anything about, I guess, the relationship with the host of bacteria based on what one can transfer from the entire food bacteria?
I think you would have to, I don't know that that could directly tell you that. I think you would then still have to do some kind of like TEM to determine where within the cell that bacterium was alive in the hosts, but it might give you a target metazoan to look at. All right, thanks.